Morning, Jim.
Robert.
Hey.
Hi, Jim.
Tree gift.
Sharing your faith doesn't have to be hard. Let's do it together.
Good morning, Crossroads. Hope you're having a good morning so far. So glad that you decided to join us here today and those of you joining us online this morning. And we are actually concluding our series we've been in the past few weeks called The Lost Cause. Now, I don't know if you've been able to join us for this series, but I know that I've been challenged in a big way about how I am joining along with the lost cause. See, God has given us the privilege and the responsibility to be people that share about Jesus, to share real hope with others. And so I hope that for you, you've been challenged, that you've been motivated to join in the lost cause and what we've been learning in this series. Because here's the thing, Crossroads, God calls every single Christ follower to be a light in this world. He's called us to be light, to be messengers of true hope. And I get it's a daunting task. I mean, even as we watch the guy on that video, it's just painful, right? If you've ever been in a situation where you have been hoping or trying to share Jesus, it's awkward. It's daunting at times. You know, in week one of our series, I shared about a story of me trying to share the gospel in Panama City Beach, Florida, back when I was in college just 3 years ago. And it's a little longer than that. But I was down there in college, and we were there for the purpose of trying to share Jesus with people. And I shared about the fact that we were just trying to come up with ideas of how to do it. So we tried to do these man-on-the-street interviews. We go up to somebody with a camera and ask these questions. Well, we tried it for the first time with this guy and this girl in front of a liquor store. And so I asked him a couple questions. We shut off the camera, and then I clumsily grab for a gospel tract, stumble my way through sharing that gospel tract, and the guy ended up at that point asking to receive Christ in his life. And actually, my friend Emily met with the other girl, and the same thing happened with her. Now, I did a terrible job of sharing the gospel in that moment, and actually, my friend Emily could testify to that, apparently. My wife actually talked to her the same day I preached and shared that story, and she's like, oh, yeah, I've shared that. She's with Crew now. She's on staff. She's like, I've shared that story with hundreds of students about how you can share the gospel terribly and still have somebody respond. I was like, well, thanks a lot, Emily. I appreciate it. I'm glad that I could inspire people. But it's true. See, in the end, right, we are a messenger. It's up to God what he's doing with that person's life. It's not our responsibility to decide what happens, but that we would be people that step out in faith and are people that believe we have a responsibility. Now, many of us, again, the thought of sharing the gospel makes our palms probably a little bit sweaty thinking about it, maybe thinking about somebody that you could do that with. Well, today, we're going to talk about a tool that you can use that you have specialized experience in. I mean, God can use this tool in your life, and you are especially equipped to use this tool. That tool is your personal testimony. Right? Every single one of us who are a follower of Jesus, we have a story to tell. Because if you came to know Jesus, there's a story about how that happened, and God can and will use it in the life of others if we're simply willing to share it when the opportunity is there. And so today we're going to look at how we can use our testimony for the lost cause. And we're going to study someone who was really a master at sharing his own story. And so we're going to be looking at the Apostle Paul, and we're going to be in Acts chapter 26. If you have your Bibles along, if you brought those, I encourage you to turn open there. We're only going to be in Acts chapter 26 this morning, so I invite you to turn there. And we're going to discover, as we look at the life of Paul, and in this moment, three steps that the Apostle Paul used to share his personal testimony. Church, your personal testimony is one of the most powerful parts of your life and your faith. And it can help us ease into conversations about spiritual things with people. And it has the power to break down walls with people that you know. And it's something that you can share over a simple conversation over a cup of coffee or a round of golf. It can be inspirational, right? Your story can be inspirational. It's irrefutable. But unfortunately, for many of us that know Jesus, we've relegated our own story to something we share maybe at our baptism if we get baptized, or at life group. Yet the primary way that Paul uses his personal testimony is to share Jesus with people that don't know him yet. Now that word testimony, when we say it as Christians, right, means something. It's kind of this Christianese that we say, and really what we're talking about is our life, how we came, basically like what God had been doing in our life to the point where we came to know him and what he's done since then. Or a testimony can simply be just sharing something that God has done in your life recently. See, church, every one of us here, if you've given your life to Jesus, we do have a story worth telling. But what too many of us don't realize is this. Your personal testimony is one of the most powerful and compelling tools you possess for the lost cause. I'm going to say that again. Your personal testimony is one of the most powerful and compelling tools you possess for the lost cause. See, God gave you your journey, your story, to be used for his glory and to be used in the life of others. And if we do use it, often what's happening is we're simply sharing it with other Christ followers, which that's great. Like, I know that I love our baptism services. We get to hear stories of life change, but yet I can't get past the fact that Paul used it as a way to share Jesus, to share faith with others. And so we're going to be in Acts 26. And to set the context of this passage, so Paul has been in custody for quite a while. He's gone through different leaders, and now we have the governor, Festus, who is in charge. And it just so happens that King Agrippa is in town. And so he gets the chance now to be before them and kind of plead his case. And what's interesting is instead of trying to convince them why he should be released, Paul decides this is the time that he wants to share his own story with these guys. And so this is going to be a really practical sermon. So we're going to jump right in. The first step to share your story is to briefly describe your life without Jesus. Briefly describe your life without Jesus. So Paul, as he said here, he's speaking with Festus and King Agrippa. This is what he says. The Jewish people all know the way I have lived ever since I was a child, from the beginning of my life in my own country and also in Jerusalem. They have known me for a long time and can testify, if they are willing, that I conformed to the strictest sect of religion, living as a Pharisee. We skip down to verse 9. I too was convinced that I ought to do all that was possible to oppose the name of Jesus of Nazareth. And that is just what I did in Jerusalem. On the authority of the chief priests, I put many of the Lord's people in prison. And when they were put to death, I cast my vote against them. Many a time I went from one synagogue to another to have them punished, and I tried to force them to blaspheme. I was so obsessed with persecuting them that I even hunted them down in foreign cities. So as Paul begins and he's going to tell his story of life change, he begins to tell them, this is who I was without Jesus. And what we find out, actually, he was a really religious guy. Super religious, but he was on the wrong path. See, he decided to set it in his mind that he wanted to be completely against Jesus and anybody that professed the name of Jesus. And it led him to want to put people that professed Jesus in jail and hopefully to be put to death. Now, notice Paul wasn't proud of his past, right? He shares briefly about it. And the reason that I said for some of us, describe your life without Jesus is so many of us, or some of us, came to know Jesus at a younger age. Like for me, I came to know Christ, I was like probably 10 or 11 where I truly realized my need for Jesus, that I could not save myself and ask him into my life. So I couldn't share a testimony like, man, I was addicted to cotton candy and pixie sticks, right? Like, sounds ridiculous, right? But I would not tell somebody that because I came to know him at a young age. Thankfully, the Lord spared me of a lot of things that I could have gone through. And so for some of us that maybe came at a young age, like it's maybe sharing like, hey, this is what my life would be without him. Like I know that I would be lost without him. But for others of you that came to Jesus later in your life, it gives people a chance to see who you were, the things that you had gone through. Maybe it's talking about where you were spiritually before meeting Jesus. What was life like? Talk about, you know, maybe your thoughts or your feelings, your actions, maybe what your relationships were like, so they could understand who you once were. Now, some of you who are Christ followers may be saying, you know, I couldn't tell them that. I'm too ashamed of who I was. But why? See, when you've been forgiven and redeemed, it's not something you brag about, but you just let people know this is who I was. And it's to give Jesus the glory and praise. And it doesn't mean that life is perfect, but it's the thing that we need to remember, church, is that your past has a purpose. Your past has a purpose to tell people, this is what used to be going on in my life, and it doesn't even mean we'll get there, but that life is perfect, right? Maybe you've been reluctant to share with other people to let them know who you once were, but we don't need to be ashamed of our past, right? We're no longer held by shame because we've been forgiven. See, God wants to use our past to impact other people, and maybe something that happened in your past that you'd be led to share would resonate with the person you have to share it with. And it's not about glorifying your past. It's not bragging about where you were. You know, you'll notice Paul, he doesn't really go on and on about his past, and he doesn't sensationalize it. And he clearly could have said a whole lot more than he did, right? But he briefly shares about his past and what his life was about. This is who I was. This is my life without Jesus. Have you ever sat down and really thought about what was your life like before Jesus and actually journaled that out? Church, if you haven't done that or maybe haven't done that in a long time, it's a chance really just to worship Jesus for what he's done in your life, what he's called you out of, what he has saved you from, and to realize as we just remembered here that your past has purpose. Will you be willing to allow your past to be used in someone else's life as you share that briefly? Now, Paul moves on to talk about his encounter with Jesus and the second step, which is to describe how you decided to surrender to Jesus. How did you decide? What's that story? So this is what Paul says. On one of these journeys, I was going to Damascus with the authority and commission of the chief priests. And about noon, King Agrippa, as I was on the road, I saw a light from heaven, brighter than the sun, blazing around me and my companions. We all fell to the ground, and I heard a voice saying to me in Aramaic, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? It is hard for you to kick against the goads." Then I asked, "Who are you, Lord?" "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting," the Lord replied. "Now get up and stand on your feet. I have appeared to you to appoint you as a servant and as a witness of what you have seen and will see of me. I will rescue you from your own people and from the Gentiles. I am sending you to them to open their eyes and turn them from the darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, so that they may receive forgiveness of sins and a place among those who are sanctified by faith in me." So Paul here, he describes the moment that his life completely changed, the moment that he met Jesus. And he was on his way to harass Christians. As he says there, he saw an incredible light. He was knocked to the ground, and then Jesus spoke audibly to him. Now, I would think that most of us can't say that God spoke in an audible voice, but we can tell you how God met us in a personal way, right? How he met us in a way that we knew without a doubt that it was him that was confronting us. Now you'll notice, you know, when Paul speaks about his conversion, he shares it in a way that is specific and personal. See, be specific about where and how you put your faith in Christ. It's okay if you don't know the date. If you know the date, great. But if not, like, when did things change? When did you know there was like a decision that you need that needed to be made? This is super important because you very well may be sharing your story with someone that thinks they're saved. Church, there's many people that think they're saved because they go to church or because they believe in God. That believing in God, simply believing in God, makes them a Christian. And there's a whole lot of people that go to church that have no idea what it means to be saved. So make it clear in your story that trusting Christ as your Lord and Savior happened at a point in time, that there was a decision that needed to be made. It didn't happen because you grew up in a Christian home or because you've gone to church. There was a decision to realize what Jesus did for your sin. Now, I'd encourage you, don't use cliches like "I got saved," "I was born again," "I asked Jesus into my heart," right? People that don't know Jesus, they don't know what that means, you know, and stay away from the, you know, Christianese, like "I was justified," "I was redeemed," "I got the Holy Spirit," right? See, those terms can confuse people, but it's a chance to really explain what happens, right? Is that you understand that you fell short, you couldn't save yourself, that your sin was a big deal, but you cried out to Jesus to forgive you, that he's leading your life now. So as you think about your own story, I mean, when was it that you came to know Jesus? What was that like? Now, if your only answer is, "I've been a Christian my whole life," then I think that's cause for concern. We need to understand that there was a point. You don't just become a Christian without a choice. Being a Christian is a decision that we made. And so if you're a person that's saying, you know, "I don't know when it was," maybe you still need to respond. Maybe you still need to respond to the grace of God and understand that Jesus died for your sin, and to ask for that forgiveness and ask him to lead your life. For those of you who can point to that date or season, again, I'd encourage you, think about how would you describe that to someone? Write that down in a way so that when you have the opportunity, you can share it with someone else. How would you share that in a way that's specific and personal? So be a person that is prepared to describe how you surrendered to Jesus. Third and finally, the third step in sharing your faith is to describe your life after surrendering to Jesus. Describe your life after surrendering to Jesus. This is what Paul says. "So then, King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the vision from heaven. First to those in Damascus, then to those in Jerusalem and in all Judea, and then to the Gentiles, I preached that they should repent and turn to God and demonstrate their repentance by their deeds. That is why some Jews seized me in the temple courts and tried to kill me. But God has helped me to this very day, so I stand here and testify to small and great alike." Paul says, this is what my life has been like. This is what Jesus has done in my life. And he shares, it hasn't been perfect. In fact, it's been really hard. It's been difficult. But he says, God has helped me. God has sustained me. And truthfully, he is the reason that I'm here today. That's what Paul is telling his listening audience. Church, what has Jesus meant for you? Has he brought you through any difficult times relating to your life before Jesus? I mean, what attitudes have changed? Maybe some relationships that have changed in a positive way. How he's changed you and how you interact in those relationships. I mean, this is your chance to brag on Jesus. It's your chance to give glory to the things that he has done in your life. Now, you'll notice as we've read here, Festus and King Agrippa, they don't interrupt him. And I think that's really interesting. Now, I don't know that we know the exact reason why, but here's why I think they don't argue with him. Because you can't argue with a changed life. You can't argue with a changed life. Paul had changed. I mean, there's no doubt. He goes from a guy who was trying to kill other Christians and kill anybody that professed Jesus to being a guy who is sold out for Jesus. The greatest evidence you can provide of your relationship with Jesus is your changed life. Has your life truly changed? Are there sins that God has dealt with and freed you of, or that you're in the process of God dealing with and freeing you of? I mean, is there a peace, a contentment, a trust, or maybe even a joy that you have that you didn't have before that you can speak about? But church, don't leave out the ongoing struggles that you have now, and this is super important. We don't want to give people the idea that Jesus just fixes everything. That's not the way it works. You know, ever since I started following Jesus, I found a spouse, and my salary's been doubled. Don't have any struggles, right? Like, my wife, we never disagree. My kids always listen to me. Everything is perfect. That might work out in Christian movies, but that's really not the way it is. They'll know you are lying. Church, the best thing that we can do is to be real. Right? To let people know that we're not perfect. Life hasn't been perfect. There's been struggles that are ongoing, and many of us are hesitant to ever share with people because we feel like we're not quite the example that we should be. Join the club. Every single one of us has different struggles, and we struggle at different times, but in humility, we can share about what God is doing. Do not buy into the lie that you can start sharing your story once it's all perfect and tidied up. Church, one of the brightest billboards of God's grace in our lives is our weaknesses, not our strengths. This world is not going to be saved by our perfection that we strive for and can never achieve. He will be saved by Jesus' perfection alone and his holiness. And so it's sharing things like, you know, this is where it was hard in my life, but I've seen Jesus help me through it. My marriage is challenging, but I believe Christ is sufficient to sustain me. Yeah, I fall back into sin at times, but this is the goodness and grace of God in my life. Here's how I try to walk closer with him every day, and here's where I have people that love the Lord as well supporting me. You can't and shouldn't convey that you are perfect. But you want to convey to them that you're forgiven and that God is doing a work in your life and he's changing you. And maybe you have an opportunity simply to share what God has done in your life recently. I mean, it can be, maybe you have an opportunity where you're not sharing about how you came to know Jesus or your life before him, but you're just saying, like, this is what I've seen God do in my life. This is how he's provided. So maybe God will give you a time, enough time for just a short testimony. Here's one thing as we continue through this and thinking about sharing our story. There's one thing that we can't forget, though. All right, maybe God gives you an opportunity and you share a part of your story, you share a testimony. But there might be a chance to go further into that conversation. See, that's not the end goal, is simply to share your story. We have another goal in mind. And that goal is revealed in the second part of verse 22. Let's continue reading. It says, I am saying nothing beyond what the prophets and Moses said would happen, that the Messiah would suffer and as the first to rise from the dead, would bring the great message of light in his own people and to the Gentiles. See, Paul here, he's being a little bit sneaky, isn't he? He's trying to share the gospel. Or he's talking about this Messiah, right? He knows who the Messiah is. They don't. And so he's trying to reveal to them who Jesus is. Church, your story can't save anybody. But we can allow our story to be a bridge to the story. Use your story to be a bridge to the story, to the gospel, to the true good news. See, your story, it gives a concrete, real-life example of what Jesus can do in a life. The response you hope for them is a response to the gospel. It's a response that they can meet Jesus too. They can meet him in a personal way like you have. And so you have the opportunity to share Jesus. to share the gospel, to share the story, the greatest news anyone could ever hear. Now, I don't know if you were here last week. If you weren't, I encourage you, go back and listen to what Pastor Scott taught us about how we can share the gospel in a simple way. That we'd be people that are prepared to actually share the gospel. But can I challenge you this week as it relates to your own story? Would you spend some time with the Lord just remembering what he's done for you and even writing down details of your story? And we can easily say, like, well, you know, when the opportunity's there, then I'll share my story. But why not prepare a little bit? Why not think about and give honor to God and glory for what he's done into your life up to this point? I encourage you to take time to process through these different components of your life without Jesus and how you came to surrender to him. And then to praise him for the things that he's done in your life so far. God can and will use your story in the lost cause if you're willing to take the opportunity. So this last July, some of you have heard about the Class A motorhome that I have. Well, I sold it, all right? I had purchased a different one, and so I sold it to a guy who lived in southern Wisconsin, and he came, purchased it, picked it up. And word to the wise, make sure that you take the license plates off the car or vehicle you would sell. So in November, I received a bill in the mail from the Illinois State Tollway. There were some unpaid tolls. So I started to do the math in my head, and I'm like, wait a second, these are from September. How in the, oh, I see what happened here. So I call the guy. Still had his number. He answered his phone, talked to him a little bit. Hey, I got these tolls. I explained the situation, and I'm like, hey, can you send me a check? It was like 50 or 60 bucks. Can you send me a check, and then can you please send me my plates? Like, I'd really appreciate that. I'm sorry that I didn't grab them. Yep, no problem. Well, December rolls around. Don't get the plates. Don't get the check. After Christmas, I read another text, Merry Christmas. Wondering, can you send me that money? So then I try to reach out to him. By this point, he's completely ghosted me. Well, in February, I got another bill. So I had already paid those tolls. I got another bill for more tolls. Now, this was from the same date. Apparently, Illinois doesn't have their stuff together. I cannot believe this. So at this point, I'm pretty frustrated. And let's just say my wife, Teresa, is frustrated. And she may be a tiny bit frustrated that I didn't take the plates off in the first place. So I try to call him one more time. I'm like, you know, I'm going to call him from a different phone number. And sure enough, he answers. And I'm like, hey, Jim, this is Zach. Can I just drive down and get those plates from you? He said, yeah, that's no problem. That's fine. So this is last weekend that I drove down. So it worked out. My wife and I had to go to a wedding in DeKalb, Illinois. My nephew was getting married. So we're driving down there. We go Friday night, spend the night. Wake up the next morning, call Jim. He answers the phone, thank goodness. I'm like, hey, can I pop over to your place? Yep, come on in. Come on over. When you get in the driveway, just pull straight back. There's a big garage, and then just go in that side door. So as I'm driving over there, I start thinking, like, is this going to be one of those, like, Facebook marketplace things that, like, go really bad? Right? Like, I'm maybe not going to walk out of this alive kind of situation. I know you guys never have thoughts like that, but I'm having those thoughts. And so I get there, I walk in his garage, I leave my wife in the car. And so I walk in there, and I'm talking to this guy, Jim, and just talking about life. And he begins to share with me just about his struggles of life. And he apologized, like, man, I had to claim bankruptcy after I bought the motorhome. And my wife has early onset Alzheimer's. And he begins to share with me just like how his retirement really hadn't turned out the way he had hoped. And wouldn't you know it, the Lord is starting to tell me, like, you got to share Jesus with this guy. And I'm like, I do not have time for this. Like, I'm like, Lord, I will listen to him, and I'll be like, God bless you or something like that. But I am not sharing Jesus. My wife already thinks I'm dead by now because I've been in here a while. And so as I'm there, I'm like, I'm arguing with God. I don't remember all of what he said because I'm basically arguing with the Lord. But the longer I sit there, I'm like, I have to talk to him. And so I begin to share what Jesus has done in my life through different struggles and how he's been a foundation in my life. And I talked to him about the gospel and shared the gospel with him. And right there in his garage, he didn't ask Jesus to lead his life. But at the end of our conversation, I said, hey, Jim, would it be okay if I pray for you and pray for your wife? And so he reached out his hand and I took his hand and I prayed for him. And by the end of that prayer, he was, well, I clearly choked up about it, but he was in a ball of tears. And he thanked me, and he gave me a hug, and I left with my license plates. But church, the reason I shall share that story is it was a reminder from something we talked about the first week of the series. Success in the lost cause isn't defined by salvation. Success is marked by obedience. And I didn't want to share. But I finally had to listen to what God wanted. And I didn't turn out the way I hoped. I hope that Jim does come to know the Lord. But it reminds us that it's really not about us, right? It's about what God wants to do. And if we're just simply people who are obedient when the moment comes, you know, are we willing to be people that share hope with others? Well, whether it's simply doing something like Pastor Adam talked about in week two about using the blessed model and loving on others or being a person that shares your own story like we talked about today or sharing the story, the gospel, like Pastor Scott talked about last week. Will we simply be people as his church that will respond when the opportunity is there that we have in front of us and trust God to do what he wants to do with it? You know, Jesus reminds us in Matthew 5, he says, you are the light of the world. And when you think about the physics of light, darkness doesn't push back light. Right? Like if I cup my hands and there's darkness in here, and if I'm like, I'm going to show you some darkness and be like, ah! Right? Like darkness doesn't fill this place. Right? It doesn't. But if you think about being in a dark space, now I'm going to ask you, before we do this, I want you to take out your cell phones. Have your cell phones ready. Just grab it and hold on to it. See, if you hold out a light, as the lights are going to come down here. But as you hold out a light in the middle of a dark room, that darkness cannot push this light back. And so I want us to reflect on the words that Jesus is saying to you. He's saying to me. He's saying, you are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. And neither do you light a lamp and put it under a bowl, but you put it on its stand. And it gives light to all who are in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before people so that they can see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. Now, if you have your phone handy, I invite you just to do this. Pull out your cell phone, hold it up. And I want all the lights, if you have them here, to fill up this space. And I want to read this verse to you one more time so you can be reminded. I mean, look at all this light that fills this room from tiny little bulbs. And Jesus is reminding all of us right now. He says, you are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. And neither do you light a lamp and put it under a bowl, but you put it on its stand and it gives light to all who are in the house. Crossroads, let your light shine before people so that they can see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. For all of you in the different spaces you go in, students in your schools, all of you that have jobs and in the tough environments you work in, you're a light of the world. Retired people, all the different environments you're involved with, you are a light to this world. Yes. May we be a church full of people that are willing to shine our light so that they can see Jesus. Amen? Amen. Let's close in prayer as the lights come up and the worship team comes out. Lord, we thank you for that reminder, Lord. You are the light of the world, but you put that light in us and proclaim that we are the light of the world if we know Jesus. And God, I pray for all of us that this series wouldn't be something that struck us right now, but God, that we'd be people that want to be a part of the lost cause, your lost cause. And even as we're going to sing here in a little bit, Lord, that we just proclaim what we've witnessed, God, of you, what you've done in our lives. Or that we'd be people who are just simply obedient when there's an opportunity there and trust you to do what you will with it. Lord, thank you for saving people, Lord. For those of us that can say, thank you for saving me, Lord, thank you for your grace. And let us be people who live out that grace and are a light in the different environments that we get to be in every day. Lord, we love you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.